Hey, thank you for joining us online. My name is Casey, and I'm one of the pastors here at Westside Family Church in Leavenworth. Today, we're not able to meet together, but that's not going to stop us from worshiping together. We're going to have a time where we're going to sing together as our Westside Family Church worship leaders in Lenexa lead us in a couple songs. And then after that, I'm going to come back and I'm going to give you week two of this series called Follow Me. In the meantime, I encourage you to download our bulletin that's linked below me, and you can download that. You can copy and paste the notes into a word processor. You can print those out so you can follow along if you got a printer at home. We're also going to have an opportunity below that you can fill out a connect card, and there you can let us know how we can help you take your next step in following Jesus. You can also share with us your prayer requests. We would love to pray with you and encourage you and celebrate what God is doing in your life. Just let us know through the connect card. Another thing you can do online is give. You can go to westsideleavenworth.com and you can click the give button and you can worship God through your generous giving. Thank you so much for joining us today. And I will be with you in a couple minutes to share with you week two of this series, Follow Me.
lead us to the Heavenly Father. That we are loved children, sons and daughters.
Crash waves and the noise washes.
Last week, we began this series by talking about the power of an invitation over information. We talked about how invitations are more influential. Invitations are more powerful than information. And that's one of the reasons why we want our kids not just to know the right thing, but to have the right friends, because we know that if they get invited by the right friend, that invitation will be more powerful than the information we give them. And Jesus led with invitations. He never led with information. In fact, we ended the teaching last week realizing the power of the invitation in every one of our lives. That when Jesus invites us, he invites us to follow him. And that invitation to follow him, when we say yes to that information, it transforms our life. Write this in your notes to get us started off today. See, everyone is invited to follow Jesus. This is what we talked about last week. Everyone is invited to follow Jesus. And those who follow him are changed. Those who choose to follow Jesus, to take their next step in loving Jesus, becoming like Jesus, and sharing Jesus. Those are the people that look back in the rear view of their life, and they look in that rear view mirror, and they go, man, I am different. God has changed me. But this is not like the follow me on Facebook or the like my post. See, this is different than that type of a follow. This is an invitation that Jesus gives us to learn from him, to listen to him, to trust in him, to obey him, and to join him in the work he has doing. I want us to go to a passage of scripture today in Luke chapter 5. So if you have your Bible, I encourage you to do that. You might want to open up your tablet or your smartphone, or if you're in a browser right now, you might want to open up another browser and go to Bible.com and look at Luke chapter 5. And I want us to look here, because today we're going to look at another one of Jesus' invitations to follow him. And today I want us to look at when he invites some of his first disciples to follow him. He had been in this land called near Galilee, the Sea of Galilee. And as he was there, he just had been baptized by John the Baptist, and he was starting his preaching career. So he was now teaching and going around on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee and teaching people about the kingdom of God. And during this time, Jesus was at the Sea of Galilee, and one day he was preaching on the shore. Luke chapter 5, verse 1 starts this way. He says, as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, so check this out, the boats are vacant, the fishermen are outside the boats, and Jesus has been teaching this crowd, the crowd's growing in on him, and he's like, man, I need to be able to get in position to teach more of these people without stepping in the water and drowning. So he uses his resources and his intuition. He goes, oh, look, a boat. He gets in the boat. He looks at the owner of the boat and says this. He goes, stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asks Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. Now you go, why did he want to get away from the crowd? No, he didn't want to get away from the crowd. See, Jesus knew that if he could get out on the water, that water would turn into an amphitheater and make his voice carry and he'd be able to teach a lot more people by getting out on the boat and pushing out a little bit into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. Jesus was a genius. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, who was the owner of this boat, now let's go out where it's deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish. Now, you got to understand something here. See, Jesus wasn't a fisherman. Jesus was a carpenter. Jesus was a carpenter who now had turned into this incredible teacher. His profession was with wood. He probably knew how to make the boat they were in, but he was not the expert like Simon was in fishing. See, Simon was an expert fisherman. In fact, Simon and his crew and maybe the other boats that were there mending their nets along the shore, they had spent all night fishing, because that's what fishermen did at night. The best time to fish was at night. So this is during the day. And Jesus comes in. It's almost like a plumber telling an electrician how to do their job. Jesus comes in, steps into the boat after he teaches this crowd. And so you got this teacher carpenter stepping into a fisherman's boat, telling a fisherman that it's time to fish. And he says, go out, let's go deep waters, and let's go fishing. And Simon replies, the expert of fishing replies, the known expert in that, says, Master, and it's interesting that he says master here. And I want you to circle that word in your notes or in your Bible because that's important here. He goes, Simon replied, we worked hard all last night because we're fishermen who know when the best time to fish is. And night is the best time to fish. And by the way, we didn't catch a thing. Then look what he says here. But if you say so, I'll let the nets down again. See, master here is a Greek word that is only used in the New Testament by Luke. He uses this to inform us of something very important because it's only, and Luke uses it 7 times in the New Testament, in his account of the gospel of Jesus. And by Luke using this, every time that he uses this word master, when the disciples say the master, they're referring to Jesus as the authority. They're referring to Jesus almost as the expert. He goes, and this is what Luke's wanting us to know. He wants us to see how the disciples respond to Jesus' authority. It's important because Simon, who we later will find out is Peter, he's renamed as Peter. Simon Peter was the authority on fishing. He was the professional. He knew all, like his fishing partners, he knew how the currents worked. He knew all about that. And he knew what was best. At least he thought he knew what was best about fishing. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever thought that you knew better than God? Have you ever thought that you knew and you thought what was best? You thought you knew what was best. Or have you ever thought that, man, what I'm thinking is best for me. What I'm thinking is best for my family. What I'm thinking is best for my relationships. What I'm thinking is really best for my marriage. And what I'm thinking is best for my kids, and what I'm thinking is best for my jobs. Maybe you've been in a place to where you thought your ideas were better than what God had for you. See, Peter was in one of these situations. And to follow Jesus, we have to acknowledge something. We have to acknowledge Jesus' authority over our lives and recognize that he knows better. So write this in your notes. See, following Jesus means letting go of what we think is best. And you might have thought, God, I've given up on my husband. There is no way possible that he can change. But you need to say this. Instead of saying, this is what I think, then but if you say so. So, God, I've tried everything I can do with my child. There is nothing I can do, but if you say so. But if you say so, I've done everything with my ex that I can, and my ex doesn't deserve this. That won't teach her, but if you say so. See, we need to learn the art of following Jesus by saying, but if you say so. One of the books I was reading, one of the authors said this regarding this passage in this part of the scripture. He said, Peter might not agree, but Peter could obey. And you might not agree with what Jesus asks us to do, but when we realize that following Jesus means recognizing that Jesus is the expert, we are not, then what that does is that gives us the ability to say, we might not agree with this, but if you say so, it's recognizing that Jesus, I trust that you know better than I know, but if you say so, I will do that. And then look what happens in the story. And this time, in verse 6, their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, and I want you to see, this wasn't what he expected. It wasn't that Jesus debunked, it wasn't that this, but Jesus debunked everything Peter knew. And now Peter who wasn't the expert now. He was standing in the middle in the presence of the one who had all authority. Look what he does. He falls to his knees before Jesus and said, "Oh, Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you." You can't encounter Jesus without discovering who you are and who you're not. You can't encounter Jesus without discovering who you're not, that you're not all that. And when we discover the love and the authority of God, we recognize that we don't deserve God. We don't deserve God to be in the boat with us. We don't deserve God to be in our life with us. And no matter how good we are or how much we know, we don't deserve to have him in our life. But the beautiful thing is that Jesus gets into our boat and he wants to be in our life. And he extends to you an invitation, just like he extends to Peter and these disciples. And it's an invitation to let him be the master of our life. And we surrender our life to him. After this, Luke talks about this in verse 9. He goes, "For Peter was awestruck by the number of fish he had caught, as were the others with him. His partners, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed." When God works in our life, when God works in your life, those around you will be amazed at God's work in you. When God begins to transform you from the inside out, and people who are watching from the outside in begin to see the change and the transformation in their life, they will be amazed at what God is doing in you as you are following them. And when we realize that God wants to have a relationship with us, and he can do amazing things like this, you know what? It makes us want to follow him. I bet after Jesus did this for Peter, James, and John, they wanted to follow Jesus. And maybe you've come to Jesus because of something, and you're following Jesus because of something Jesus has done for you. Maybe he's changed your perspective on life. Maybe he's given you joy when you didn't have joy. Maybe he's helped your marriage. Maybe he's helped you. Maybe because of what he's done for you, you want to follow him. See, write this in your notes. People begin following Jesus because of what Jesus can do for them. There's nothing wrong with that. People come to Jesus, and most of the crowd follow Jesus because of what Jesus could do for them. Maybe you're watching this today because you hope that Jesus can do something for you. There's nothing wrong with coming to Jesus with this mentality of what God can you do for me. But we need to realize something. We need to realize what happens next in the story, because what happens next in this story is what God wants to do with our story. While Peter, James, and John were amazed at what Jesus did for them, and while they might have followed Jesus because of the fish that they had caught, Jesus had a plan for them. Jesus had a plan for these fishermen. And Jesus replied to Simon this way. Let's go on our text. "Don't be afraid." What's he saying? Don't be fearful. I want you to be faithful. Don't be full of faith. Don't be full of fear. I want you to be full of faith. From now on, Jesus says, you'll be fishing for people. You're not going to be the expert anymore. I'm going to step in and I'm going to teach you now how to fish for people. And as soon as they landed, look what happens. They left everything and followed Jesus. Jesus is up front with you and I. Jesus is up front with his disciples about what his end goal is for his disciples and for us. See, Jesus is thinking, and we might be thinking, Jesus, I'm following you for what you can do for me. But you know what Jesus is thinking? I want you to follow me, not just for what you can do for me, but what you can do with me. And Jesus wants us to join him on this mission in learning how to fish for people. Jesus wants to use our following him to show us what we can do with him. And this is what Jesus would do. See, Jesus would take people that would follow him for what he did for them, and he would allow them to become fishers of men. He would take a turn of demoniac and into those who would fish for men. He would heal the demoniac, and all of a sudden that demoniac would go and share his story of how he set free. And people will ask, "Who did this for you?" And he'd go, "This man Jesus did it." He would take an adulterer who who was had a past of shame. And he would remove her shame and give her life and forgiveness. And he would do that. And she would go and share her story of how free she is. And in turn, she would fish for people by sharing her story. Jesus would turn people that came to him for what he could do for them into people who can learn to fish for people. And that's the series big idea that I'm leaning into. But before that, write this in your notes. See, Jesus makes all who follow him into people who fish for women and men. Jesus makes everyone who follows him into people who fish for women and men. And this is the big idea that I want you to know today. The big idea for today's teaching is to follow is to fish. Write that in. To follow is to fish. You can't follow Jesus without being recruited to fish for people. You can't follow Jesus and not let his life change you, and all of a sudden that life change in you will be something that will attract other people to come and experience the life of Jesus that you've experienced. To follow Jesus is to fish for people. To follow is to fish. He wants to teach you and I the art of catching people for Jesus. He wants to teach you how to listen to his voice. He wants to teach you to look at people through his eyes. He wants to teach you to discover who he's working in. And he wants to teach you, and he wants to teach me, how to fish for people. That's one of his end goals for your life, is to turn you into someone who can fish. Fish for people. Now, if you're like 98% of the people listening to this, you just felt the brick hit the bottom of your stomach because of fear, because you didn't sign up for this. In fact, when you signed up for him, is you've signed up to follow Jesus. You signed up for what Jesus, maybe because of what Jesus could do for you. And you didn't sign up to become a fisherman. You didn't sign up for that. You didn't sign up to share your story. You didn't sign up for that. That's what preachers do. That's what people on this side of the screen are supposed to do. That's what people with microphones and those guys are to do. You know, you don't want to be a salesman and have to have that elevator pitch at just the right time. That's not what you signed up for. And there's a lot of fear in this. And then you might even think, I've got nothing in my life to share. Why would somebody want to hear from me? How would my life want to bring somebody to Jesus? But Jesus' reality is to follow him, he wants to make you into a fisher of women and men. See, only a small portion of people actually want to be a fisherman. But the reality is God teaches all of us to become fishermen. This wasn't the motive, this might not have been the motive by which you came to Jesus. See, you and I may have come to Jesus because we didn't want to go to hell and we wanted to go to heaven. Maybe that's one of the reasons you came to Jesus. Maybe you came to Jesus because of you needed Jesus to do something for you. Or maybe you needed Jesus or God, you needed God to fix something for you. And that's maybe why you came to Jesus. But the thing that Jesus wants to do in your life and the thing that Jesus wants to do in my life is reveal to you and I the purpose of our life. And that's to join him in his mission of fishing for people. In his love, he puts up with our impatience. He puts up with our selfish motives. And it's okay to want to come to Jesus for what he does for us. But he turns those and turns us into fishers of people, fishermen. It's a journey. It's a journey Jesus wants to take you on. And he might, in his love and mercy, take us from our selfish ambitions for what we want to get from God. And he takes us on a journey for how we can leverage the life that he's given us and the change that he's brought us through and what he's done for us to work with him in fishing for people. It's a journey Jesus wants to take us on with the end result to be people who leads people to Jesus. Write this in. Jesus, this is the journey that he wants to take us on. Jesus wants me to seek out who he is. He wants all of us to seek out who he is. Therefore, you can write in your notes, when you seek out who Jesus is, I'm a seeker. It's okay to have questions. Jesus wants us to ask questions and seek out answers. I will always be seeking Jesus. And then the next part of my journey is Jesus wants me to believe in and trust in him. Therefore, when I'm believing and trusting in Jesus, I'm a believer. Jesus wants me to have that moment like Peter had. That moment when Peter realized that Jesus was authority and he declared, Master, and you are the authority. You author life and you give me life. And so whatever you say, I'll do it. But as you say, I will do it. And Jesus wants us to always be growing and trusting in him. It's a growth. You never stop trusting in Jesus. You never stop believing in Jesus. I'm always believing in Jesus. And Jesus wants us to continue our journey and wants me to follow his way of life. I, therefore, as I follow Jesus, I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm always responding to his invitation to take my next step in becoming more like him. I'm always responding in his invitation to love him and therefore share him with the world around me. See, Jesus wants me to put my belief into action. He wants my faith to walk itself out. He wants me to trust in his way, even if I don't agree with it. He wants me to trust in it and obey it and follow it. And then Jesus, the end result of the journey, is Jesus wants me to lead others to follow him. And therefore, if I can influence somebody else to follow him, if therefore I am a leader and I'm always going to be leading someone who is seeking Jesus, maybe someone who's just putting their belief in Jesus and beginning to trust in Jesus, or I'm beginning to lead someone who is following Jesus. See, Jesus wants to leverage your life and Jesus wants to leverage my life and my journey to lead others through the same path that I've traveled. Walk with people through their questions. As if they have the same questions about God and life and the purpose of life that you've had, as you've sought Jesus and as you continue to seek Jesus, you can help them in that stage of life as they seek Jesus, and you can lead them through that. You can fish for people through the experience and the same questions that you've had and you've had answered. You can walk with people through their journey, and you can lead people through their journey. You can fish for people and help people in their journey of trusting in Jesus as the authority of their life. You can walk with people through their journey of how they live like Jesus and live in the authority and as Jesus as their authority and savior of their lives. Why? Because to follow is to fish. To follow is to allow my life to lead others to follow Jesus. But I get that you're scared. I get that. I get that you're scared to fish for people. I mean, I am. I won't deny that some of the questions that I ask is, what do I say? What if they don't agree? Or what if I don't know what to say? Or what if I look like a fool? What if my life isn't that compelling? See, I'm not responsible for that. You know what I'm responsible? I'm responsible to obey. I'm responsible to say, Jesus, you're the master, and if you want me to fish, then I want to use my life to fish for people. So I believe this is what Jesus would say to you. Don't be fearful. Be faithful. Don't be full of fear. Excuse me. Be full of faith. Write this in. Following Jesus means allowing what has happened in my life to lead others to the source of eternal life. That's what following Jesus. That's how we fish for people. We fish for people by allowing our life and what has happened to us and through us and in us to lead others to the source of life. And then, write this in your notes, teach them to follow him. Allow how God has helped you to help others. God has put you exactly where he's put you for a specific reason. And write this in. See, God has positioned me, he's positioned you, where I live, work, and play, where you live, work, and play, to fish for people. There are people far from God all around you. There are people far from God where you have fun and you hang out. There are people far from God where you work and around you in the cubicles or in the office there. There are people far from God on the field where you are. There are people far from God everywhere around you. And God wants you to see people the way he sees people. God wants you to look at them and he wants you to open your eyes that your call now is to follow him Because to follow him is to fish. God wants to use you where you live, where you work, where you play, where your kids go to school, the parents that go there, the children that go there are all people. And the people that are far from God, God has positioned you there to fish for people. Why? Because to follow is to fish. But we all have to remember something. Write this in. This is something you need to remember, and I need to remember. I was a fish once. I was someone far from God. And someone came into our life, came into your life. And with, at the right time, in the right situation, you were receptive to the message that they had. Why? Because there was, they had a common connection with you. And it was the right person at the right time in the right situation in your life with the right method and the right approach. And that led to your receptivity. And it's through their life that they shared with you, and it might have been a difficulty. Maybe it was a divorce that you went through and they went through a divorce and they shared with you how God helped them. Maybe it was through the loss of a job. Maybe it was through a difficulty or a pivotal circumstance in your life that someone just came at the right time and they shared a good news with you. Maybe it was something to help you. And it was during that time that you began to follow Jesus. And God allowed their life, and they followed Jesus by sharing their life with you. And they fished for you. See, we were all fish once. Every one of us who have put our faith in Jesus at one time were a fish. And if it weren't for someone to fish for us, then we wouldn't have our faith in Jesus. So to follow is to fish. And I want you to know this, write this in, that God has perfectly shaped you, equipped you, and positioned you, and called you to fish for someone. To follow Jesus is to fish. So let me ask you, are you ready to fish? Are you ready to take your next step? And you might be, well, I've got all these questions, yeah? But are you ready to recognize that Jesus wants to take you on a journey? And in your questions, you continue to seek him. And maybe at one point you'll put your trust in him and you'll continue to follow him and put his teachings into practice. But you understand that whenever and whoever people follow Jesus, Jesus has a goal for them. It's to fish for people. That's why at Westside Family Church, we believe that everyone is called to lead someone to Jesus. And God has called you to lead someone to Jesus. So what is your next step? Are you ready to fish? Why? Because to follow is to fish. I want to give you a couple next steps. Maybe you would like to share your life in a very intentional way. We're going to have Group Link in a couple weeks on January 29th. And we're looking for 10 people to open up their home, to become a host, so they can allow their life in a simple way of just opening up their home to fish for people, to help people take their next step in following Jesus. Maybe you would like to do that, and you'd like to be one of the 10 homes that create a host group for a series we're doing called One Question That Changes Everything. And in this, this will be a practical series. You'll be given discussion guides. You don't need to know answers. All you need to do is have a heart for people, open your home, serve a few snacks, and be able to tell a few friends. And this is all we'd ask, is you to open your home. And you can have these discussion questions that will recap a little bit of the teaching from the previous Sunday, and you guys can follow Jesus together. And maybe through your life, you'll be able to share your experiences, and through other people, they'll be able to share through their experience, and you can follow Jesus together. Can you be one of these 10 homes? And if we had 15 host homes, that would be great. But would you be one of those 10 that can open your home and host a group? Maybe you need to get in a group and you need to follow Jesus with somebody else. Maybe you've got questions. You need to take that next step, knowing that Jesus wants you to fish for people eventually. Yeah, but you need to take your next step. And maybe you don't even know what your next step is. I want to encourage you that if you don't know what your next step in following Jesus is, we have a Get Connected that we're going to have here in our church building on February 5th. And you can sign up for that. There's a link below to sign up for Get Connected. Fill out that form and come to Get Connected on February 5th, and you'll be able to discover what your next step is on this journey that God wants to turn you into a fisher of men and women. Another way that you can take a next step is maybe you want to leverage your life and some skills that you have and serve. Maybe there's an opportunity you'd like to serve. There's a link here that you can fill out a form and you can say, hey, I'm ready to start serving. I'm ready to allow God to lead me to help fish for people. And by serving on a church on a weekend, everything we do here, one of the things that we want to do is make Jesus famous and people invite people who are far from God to come and hear the good news of who Jesus is. And so maybe you would like to serve with kids or with students in our high school, middle school environments, or you would like to help in another way that we have listed. I encourage you to take a next step and realize that God has called all of us to fish for people. To follow is to fish. Let me pray for us. Jesus, I'm so thankful that you have set the mark clearly for all of us, that there's no ambiguity as to what you're wanting to make us when we choose to follow you. And it's a little daunting. It's a little hard. It's a little tough to swallow. And so, Jesus, I ask that in this, maybe there are people here today that this creates some fear. I pray that you ease their fear and give them the courage to step out in faith and say, Jesus, I may not know all the answers, or I may not know how my life can be used of you, but may you use my life to help people discover you. And there may be people here that they know they should be fishing. They know that they need to be in a way sharing their life with others in some way. Maybe their next step is to get into a life group, or maybe their next step is to lead a life group, or to maybe be a host of a life group today. I pray that you give them the courage to make that step. God, I know that every one of us, you've called to fish for people, and there might be people that have come to our mind that you want us maybe just to invite over for dinner. And it might not be that we share you with them, but we just share our life with them. And in sharing our life with them, they see the life that's in us, and that sparks a question for them to seek out the reason for the life and the joy in our life. And in so doing, we become a fisher of people. And through our life, we can share your life with them. Jesus, I pray that you continue to give us the courage to join you on this mission to fish. Why? Because to follow you is to fish with you. In your name, Jesus. Amen. Thank you so much for watching today. We will see you next Sunday in our church building as we continue the series, Follow Me.